Good morning, Director of IIM Bangalore, other faculty, alumni and students. It's a privilege to be here. It gives you a great feeling when you are walking back to your alma mater and really talking to people in the same place. I'm doubly overjoyed with SBI being here because I was just sharing with Mr. Madhukar that they funded my education at IIM Bangalore, which was then a princely 14,000 rupees. I had to sort of go to SBI regularly to get my money. So it's great to be here. And I think the topic is something which is pretty interesting. I think it's one area which is something which one has faced right through one's career. And so I thought I'm going to really today try to share with you as to how I understand this word. It's obviously a pretty large loaded word, and it moves in different, it works differently in different contexts. The second thing I wanted to leave with you is that, see, I think the biggest for me disruption I have seen personally in life has been when I left out of the campus. I used to be one of those very timid and pretty introverted person who really knew something about whatever I studied in the 2 years here. But I never thought I would ever make it in any organization. I thought I would end up ending some supply chain or something of that sort. But at the end of the day, I think the good thing about today's world is substance wins over style. So ultimately, the content that I really went through really helped me to reach wherever I reached. So I want to leave you that as a good thought, because when you get the privilege of being in such great institutes, I think what you really get is content and substance. And I think hopefully this should stand you in good stead as you go along. Now I'm going to spend a few minutes sharing what I understand on disruption. So I think disruption is something which has been part of life, as Professor Raghuram alluded to. But I think of late it has become pretty, the rate of disruption has been growing up in many ways. Disruption is normally used to describe an impact, very impactful discontinuity, and in many ways, every disruption has made the world evolve. And I think this is something we should look at very positively, because unless there is a discontinuity or a disruption, the world would not evolve. And I have my own theory, and this has been learned from so many of the practitioners you see across the world. I feel that the time of disruption really arises when, in an organization or an industry context or a market context, when the rate of internal thinking around strategy and execution is actually lower than the aspirations of the consumers to community. I believe when this state arises in any context, then I think it is time for somebody to disrupt, because there is a gap. There's a gap between expectation and actual action. So that's always, it's something which you can really fit any disruptive context to. You would find, and it can be, it works whether it is social, within a community, economic, marketing, nations. I think it's all finally triggered by a rate of expectation of something outside the context, wanting more than what is being delivered. I think in today's world, digitization has become a way of life. Everything, every business is getting digitized. But the key thing we all have to understand, that the more you digitize, the more chances of you getting disrupted. Because digitization comes with it what I call as democratization. I mean, you really have everything visible to everybody. So disruption becomes easier. While digitization is a way of life, I think disruption really follows digitization very well. There are, as we talk, a lot of businesses which are getting seriously disrupted. And these new waves are disrupting every company in the world. And I just thought I would give you a bit of a relief in terms of this play out, which is very normal. It's a hilarious conversation between a consumer and Alexa, which really almost leaves the ordering of something away from a brand into a space which is really something no company would be prepared for if you are a branded company. And I later come down to an actual example of how a very large company had lost its plot while really ignoring this. The one clear indication that there is disruption on the way is that even in a market like the US, where people have really built their businesses over decades, the larger corporations are getting really slowed down by a whole lot of small corporations which are taking them on. This statistics really tells you a story which is quite worrisome for a large corporation, and it is worrisome for especially organizations like ours. Now, this is another big sort of transformation which has happened. If you look at in 20 years, literally the top market cap list has dramatically changed. All of you would have read it. I'm sure this is something which all of you would have gone through. But just see the value that has been created. 7 out of the top 10 companies have a market cap of US dollars, almost $5 trillion, which almost makes it the third largest nation. And all these businesses are pretty much platform based. And so this should tell you a story that the world is moving into a space which was not what was happening in the last 20 years. Look at Apple as a company. You could put all their products on a dining table or a large table, and they really generate $60 billion turnover out of it. And this is a huge change from a company which was that size a decade back. You could not possibly accommodate all their products within the IIMB campus for the same turnover. So it just tells you how dramatically this change is happening. And in the FMCG space, what's happening is all FMCG companies are to some extent struggling because of lack of differentiation. They have really followed each other without disrupting and got themselves into this situation. But at the same time, when we come into disruption, it's important to understand. I think today everybody talks of AI and blockchain and believe that if you embrace or you know it, it's going to disrupt. But I'm going to come in later to tell you that disruption has far larger context. Because if I go out to any meeting, I hear only these words, AI, MI, blockchain, technology. I mean, I sometimes don't even know whether people who are talking about it know what it's all about and how relevant it is to them and how they're going to use it to disrupt. Disruption is not really talking a few jargon. So I want to really touch a bit, having given you a bit of a preamble, I want to really touch a bit in terms of what are the elements which are causing disruption today. And I'm just touching the elements which, in my view and my experience, I feel are going to keep disrupting the way the business is done. And I'm strictly adhering to business here. And I want you to also know this is my view, and it's not, it may be in a different order when you go through the courses here. The first one is the world order. The world is pretty confusing today because on one side, it all looked like it's going to become a borderless world. There were hundreds of books written about where the world is going to have no border and it's going to be one world. And then we have seen in the last few years that the whole thing is now being twisted on its head and people are really going in for protectionism. You are now seeing the famous US-China fight on tariffs. I mean, India, every time there is a problem, look at tariff. So it's actually confusing. You really are planning in a context which is not very clear, which is pretty fluid, and it is literally dictated by the thought of that particular moment or that context. And I believe this is a very, very important disruptive area. And I think it's something which we need to keep closely watching, because a lot of decisions is based on what you believe is the world order in terms of business possibilities. That's I think the first one I would put in. The second is technology. When I refer to technology, I refer technology of any kind. Digitization is one aspect of technology. What has technology done to disrupt business? I think technology has brought in a far higher rate of change. I believe disruption happened. It did happen in the early 1900s. It did happen when I went to work in 1983. It is just that the rate of change has changed. Earlier, you would have a disruption every 15 years. Then it moved to every 15 months. Now you could have disruptions every 15 weeks. And these are really prompted by technological change. Because when somebody has an enhanced technology or way of doing things, obviously the rate of change can move faster. Today, people are willing to experiment with almost untested technology. These versions of mobile phones, most of these mobile phones are really not complete. But people put it into the market, you will find that the mobile phone will hang once in a while. And you will wonder, why is it hanging? You will find that there is a bug. And they knew that there was a bug and they released it with a bug. Because they knew in the next version they will correct it. Because they don't want to waste time to disrupt. So technology is a very critical area which you need to really keep track of if you want to be on top or ahead in terms of disruption. The third area is climate change. Now we can believe, we don't have to believe, may not be backed by 100% science, but the fact is that climate change is here for real. And so, what is the implication for business? The implication for business is that you need to really bring in huge amount of disruption in the way you do your business so that you adhere to basic sustainability principles, where you need to ensure that you do not add to any carbon footprint or other aspects which affect climate change while you keep growing your business. I mean, this is something which has cropped up in the last decade, and it is something which is going to really disrupt businesses in a big way, because the world is still not put the throttle on this. It won't be long before somebody with 100% sustainability principles embedded would operate at a cost which is 10% cheaper than somebody who's not, because that's the sort of penalties you may have to end up paying. The next area is, give or take, this rising inequality is a definite disruptor, because it has huge social impact, political impact, and finally anything which has large impact politically and socially will have impact on business. Whether we like it or not, 25 to 30% of the world are poor. And this is a disruption in a big way, positively and negatively. If you want to operate a country like India, you really have 800 million people who are on very low sort of affordability base. So if you really don't have something which can disrupt to give them what they want, you really will find India a very unviable business. So it is a very important disruptor which most businesses don't look at. I mean, for especially businesses coming from outside India to India, this is something it takes them a long while to figure it out, because most of them come and stay in five-star hotels in swanky metros, and then they don't realize that 200 kilometers down the road, you don't see anything of what you see around the hotel. So it's something which is, I believe, a major disruptor. And lastly, I believe, and this is something which I strongly believe, that relevance is becoming very important. At least today's generation and context, nobody wants to touch anything which they don't feel is relevant to them. And so you need, and this is what I call democratization. You have to really give people exactly what they want. Earlier, people used to always move to the center. They will adjust. So that was the era of mass production. You could give anything you want. As long as it broadly met your expectations, people were willing to really buy it, whether it was the goods or services. Today, people want it absolutely customized. They want exactly what they want. So which essentially means that you have to create relevance. And similarly, people want all specialized goods and services to be available very easily. And I'm going to cover this later when I take up the example of Kodak. Because if you see today, who wants a camera? There would be 0.1% of the overall population of the world who would want a camera. That I call is democratization. You get it along with a mobile. I mean, this is the most democratic thing you can have. You talk, you see, like I would possibly see my movie, I talk on the phone, I use that as my camera. So it's a one, that's democratization at its best. And it's so easy, like anybody can do it, nobody has to. I remember when I first took a photograph, somebody had to coach me for 2 hours to make me understand what aperture, light, this, that and all. In your camera, on your mobile phone, it is as easy as that. So, and I think that's a big disruptor today. Anybody who can give a product or services in this form can kill an industry. Because people are very happy with what they have. The next big disruption may happen to the televisions. Because you can see other electronic instruments all coming in with the capability of giving you as good a quality as a television set. So maybe 10 years from now, we would be talking about the television companies like we are talking about Kodak today. Because Everybody is democratizing it. You don't need to have separate television at home. You could be carrying your TV with you in your briefcase or whatever. So I think these, according to me, are five huge elements of disruption. There are obviously many more, but these constantly are evolving. And as I said, the key thing for all of us to observe is that this is happening at a really rapid pace today. And it is important for us to keep tracking what is happening in these things. So I'm going to take an example, because this example is in public space and everybody knows about it. We all know how a great company got killed. I think most of them didn't till few months before the event. Actually, nobody ever thought that this event would happen. So I'm going to take from Peter of Singular University how he has described it. And I think it's a great way of really putting the context. I think all of us knew that Kodak was the ultimate in photography. They did develop the digital camera. They were the first to really invent the digital camera. They invented it. The quality they had was not up to the mark. And these were professional photograph company which really believed in ultimate quality. So they said, we are not happy with it. So instead of that, they went and launched an even higher end conventional camera, which was like the ultimate in the world. It did do well, and that is a deception phase. So when you do inside out, you are very happy because you thought, my competitive advantage is conventional photography. I do the best in this. Now I've done something better than the best. The world is happy. I'm getting revenues. Very good. Then in came Sony with a digital camera, which did not have the same quality as Kodak. But they came in, and the existing market got disrupted because it was easy to handle. They started the democratization process. You don't have to be a professional in photography. You didn't have to be having photography as a hobby to know about it. You just had a camera, you just kept clicking. It worked. What happened? Kodak didn't see the message. The actual number of roles which were being processed started declining. So money was actually moving out of their business. These guys were happy because they were seeing the share numbers. They were very happy that we are still holding on to share. And this is how boardroom discussions went, like, we have held our share. So how does it matter? Money was going out of your business. And so suddenly what happened, the whole camera got eliminated because we had people bringing in as part of mobile phones. And that, after dematerialization, was the democratization of the camera. And today, we all know what democratization means. I think every one of us walk around with a camera in our pocket. And this is something Kodak never saw when they tried their disruption with the digital camera. They knew this was coming, but they never saw that this was going to get democratized. And this is the trend every technological breakthrough can really take you to. So that is why it is very important we really keep an eye on what's happening. Because if Kodak had woken up at the time that they saw that their processing revenue was dropping, they could have still acted and they could have saved themselves. So finally they retained the share, but of a business which had almost hit zero. Simple mathematical equation, 75% of zero really doesn't take you anywhere. So I think this is a great example of how a disruption can start, and if you are not on top of it and you don't embrace it quickly, if you are not the disruptor, then this is what can happen to you, that you could just become history. And this is why I strongly believe, and I will come to it later, as to the entire process of running a business, of seeing the future, has to change. Because technology is something which is a serious disruptor, which we need to really keep in mind. Now, what is happening today is, historically, huge businesses which have always walked through so easily in their life are struggling today. And this is the truth. I mean, most people may not come out of it. And when you have a large base, you obviously have the momentum, I mean physics, to continue for some more time. So if you don't figure out, you're going to be in problems. So I thought I will take you some of the basic inhibitors for your ability to embrace disruption in big enterprise. The first one is this, I believe it's this paradox of expertise. You believe, because you, when you run a big business and you've built it over decades, you have deep expertise in that business. and you have that deep expertise around your brand, your category, your industry, and you have this blind confidence that since I'm the best in this industry, I can really win, whatever anybody does. I mean, the other example is Nokia. They had the smartphone with them. They really got the first smartphone first. But they thought, like, we are so big, it's going to take 10 years for somebody to disrupt us. Third year, Nokia was out of business because they didn't anticipate the rate at which smartphones will take over. So this paradox of expertise is good. It's actually competitive advantage on one side, but it is also actually one of your derailers when disruption happens, because you take so much more time to come to terms with the fact that you have been disrupted. And the basic problem, even if you see us as individuals, we always have a zone of comfort in what we know. And we try to find solutions for every problem within the space of what we know. We are scared to step out of the space of what we know because we don't know anything there and you have to learn. So disruption is somewhere where you will have solutions only in what you don't know. And you have to be key to moving there. The second is strategic blindness. This is a very common thing with all businesses. We basically our inability to see beyond our own strategies, which are based on our own competitive advantage, which may not be relevant post-disruption of a business. So it is important for us to keep touch with what's happening in the marketplace if we do not already look at the future and see what we should be doing to manage the future. And this is something which has taken a lot of people to the cleaners, and this was also the same Kodak situation where they were very happy with what they did. They were seeing some results and they got carried away by that. The third is preserving the past. I believe that people who are conservative think that they have something to conserve. And that's the problem is you can keep conserving it and become a museum, which is what Kodak has become, or you can keep moving out of your past and look at the future and be willing to reorient yourself to the future. I think past preservation, especially in India, is an inherent huge part of our DNA. We believe that what worked for us a million years back will work for us for the next million years. May not. I think you need to learn. I think the other thing about businesses and essentially when you get into a corporation, small, big, is I think this collision avoidance is a big thing. If somebody has some idea, you really don't want to really have any collision, because this whole concept of the corporate world, which is just a manifestation of what happens in the communities, is can we really find a balance between your idea and my idea? Then we are in good shape. Then both of us are at peace and we go ahead. But that doesn't work, because if something is going to be disrupted, you're not satisfying the external requirement, then it's important for you to really confront each other and out of which ideas come. This collision avoidance is a big, big one. And finally, I think the world always likes to play on averages. This is my principle. You take a society, you take a community, you take politics, you take anything. You put people at two extremes, they will all try to come to the center. And the world likes to play on average. And I believe most systems love mediocrity, because that's where the average is. And that's what is huge level of comfort for the world. But the world has changed. Today, at least with the new millennials coming into play, I think people are willing to play they want things at the extremes. They are no longer happy with the averages. And this is what all aspects of society is struggling with. And this is important, because playing on the average is terrible. In India, somebody is getting no money at all, earning no money, and somebody is earning money on par with the richest person in the world. Now, if you play to the average, yes, you just see how disastrous it is. It makes no sense. So I think playing on the average is, that era is gone. And I think that's one of the reasons giant businesses have made their fortunes playing on the averages. Because that's what prompted this era of mass products, mass broad brand building, mass advertising. Everything was based on playing on the averages. So today, though, averages doesn't work. So I wanted to just give you a small example from the US. Basically, I don't know how many of you have heard of this. There is a club called the Dollar Shave Club. In the US, Procter & Gamble had a serious position in the shaving systems market. They had a market share which was massive, which was 72%. They called the shots. They were obscenely priced, as they are even today, for those who use Gillette. So they were really ruling the roost, and they had come to a stage where they stopped hearing the consumer. They were really having great time milking the business and making a lot of money. Then a group of guys who were really irritated with this whole shaving. See, shaving is not something for the females here in terms of for us in the morning to shave is not a great feeling. It's painful. On top of it, if you find that your blade has become blunt, it's even worse. And then you know that you pay through the nose to buy the blade. And then it's not available. Your system is not available in the shop that you are having next to your house. So these guys, in a group, heard about the fact that people really had a lot of problems with their shaving system. So they created they were a motley bunch. So they went to a company called Dorco, which had a lot of excess capacity. So they said, "You please make the razors and the blades for us." And they found a sort of an online home delivery mechanism, where they delivered actually product at a dollar to the home, and based on advertising which was almost really personally done, their CEO or founder went and gave a video on YouTube and started this whole model. And believe it or not, in 5 years' time, they built a $250 million business. They got 17% of the market, and Unilever bought that business for $1 billion in 2017. Just imagine the power of disruption. This had no technology, nothing. It was just that the consumer was sick and tired of going the Procter & Gamble way, because they were not talking to them at all. Now, these people have a 500 core consumer who are actually called on a regular basis. They hear what are their problems, and immediately the problems are sort of sorted out, and then in the next delivery it comes in. So being responsive to that rate of change of the consumer's aspirations created a huge business. And this is what I think all of us need to understand. For disrupting business, you really don't need to have a fantastic infrastructure or hearing mechanism. You, as long as you're hearing the consumer and you are finding that the consumer expectations are different from what you are offering the consumer, you have a disruption possibility. And this is why I started with that whole theory of disruption finally happens when people are not happy. And that's why revolutions happen. Revolutions in society also happens when people are unhappy. And people who are ruling the place don't really figure that out. Now, how do we really embrace disruption? I think in very layman terms, I have tried to really, I believe the trend is to really democratize your business. When I say democratizing your business, I'm talking about making your business relevant to every single person. It's in very simplistic terms, that's what I really mean. And if you do that, you really can embrace disruption easily, because I don't think I'm saying anything new. It is basically what Levitt said in his Marketing Myopia article. I'm sure all of you would have got it. So it is the same. I mean, the broader you define yourself, the more easier it is for you to embrace disruption. The more narrower you really define yourself, the more difficult it is for you to embrace disruption, because any disruption will be outside your definition. And that's very important. So I think, how do you do that? I think you can do that by really hearing the consumer, hearing the external world with maniacal discipline. It's important to really make it a maniacal discipline. Whatever I do, I don't do. Every month I try to meet 30 consumers. Hear them out. That's the only way you can cut the noise and hear from the person who actually is the person you should be relevant to. So it's important that we do that with maniacal discipline. We need to be bold, because you cannot embrace disruption if you're not bold. Because sometimes when you really embrace disruption, you will be disrupting yourself. And it's not easy to disrupt yourself, because you suddenly, night to morning, you're going to move out of your zone of comfort into something which is very uncomfortable. So you need to have bold leadership. You should have brilliant basics. I mean, that's where I believe substance is more important today than ever before. I think this general CP syndrome or class participation and stuff doesn't really help anymore. you really should know what you're talking about. So you have to be really good on the basics. And finally, you should train yourself to think disruptively. It doesn't come very naturally. Most of us actually love to think analog. To think digital is very tough because we are made to think in an analog manner. We are not made to disrupt us our thinking every day. That's what you are taught from the time you really start realizing where you are. So I think disruptive thinking is something you should practice. And my view is, how do you really do that? You need to make your real purpose very broad-based. Like, I'm just giving you some examples of Google, Ford, how they have redefined their narratives. And you would see these narratives are all encompassing. It can mean anything you want to do in this world. So with the result that you are constantly tracking such a broad space that you can really see disruption coming, or you can disrupt business yourself. So this is something which you will find that, imagine Starbucks says inspired by nurture the human spirit. One person, one cup. I mean, it's as broad as you can define your business to be. So I have tried to really look at my own empirical model to embrace disruption. And I really wanted to put it in very simplistic terms. See, the first many years of my work life, we always were taught this whole system of forecasting. So if you had to really plan for the future, somebody will give you this bigger notebook earlier. Now you get a file which will give you all the past trends, data, this, that, and all that. And they say, now you project for the next 10 years. That's what we did. And today, it is the surest way of disaster, because the future is not going to be anything like the past. And these trends would not in any way be useful. I believe today you should be really backcasting. And this is not a fully evolved discipline yet. Most companies talk about it, but they have not embraced it completely. Backcasting is, you need to, based on today's disruptions, visualize what the world will be 10 years from now, 5 years from now, and start doing things today which will make you successful 5 years from now. This is easier said than done. It is very, the traditional strategy, strategic model, and what everybody talks about is, look at what is the key factor of success, look at what your core competencies are, how do you build competitive advantage using that. That's hugely inside out. And the world is moving with huge disruption in the external world, in the outside world. So this model will no longer be relevant. Today's world is on outside-in basis, because the community and consumer aspirations have outstripped what the industry thought. And that's why you have so many companies who are platform-based, who have become big, many of whom have not created any economic value even now. Because they are really satisfying the aspirations, they are figuring out the business model to make money. And that's the stress everybody will go through. Because some of these, when you backcast, you would be entering space where you may not have serious leverage of your present competitive advantage or core competence. You need to really see how you can really use a part of it, but design yourself to really be relevant to that disruption. So it's easier said than done. While a lot of people are talking about it, I have not seen too many people who practice it, because this, as I said, the biggest thing is you would be your biggest competitor then. You don't look at somebody on the other side to be your competitor. You really will become your own competitor, because you say that I'm going to expect this disruption 3 years from now, so I will compete against myself and ensure that I'm the leader even when the disruption happens. Imagine if Kodak had killed their own conventional photography business and created a digital camera business, they would be flying. And they would have been a case study in another way for the world. So, but that's tough to do. I mean, it's easier said than done. So, and I think today it's all about getting a great view of the customer. I mean, if you don't really understand the consumer, because the change that you see in terms of their aspirations and expectations is phenomenal. So I personally feel that from our perspective, this is more the way I work. I mean, I'm not taking it out of any book, so it's the way I look at disruption and embracing disruption. the starting point of all this, the consumer aspirations are dramatically changing. I mean, this is something, give or take, this is real. You could just have some debate about how fast or how slow. So what happens then? You need to keep track of it. There is noise. So we need to redefine whatever data analytics we have been used. Because most of our data analysis, at least in conventional companies, has been inside out. We've really not layered in enough of outside trends, because some of these have to be really, they may not be really directly related to your industry. They would be in the space of adjacencies to your industry. The supply chain, most of our supply chain is actually made for mass production. For taking a product which is consumed by 100 million people, which can take its own time to get supplied, this is no longer going to work. Somebody today gets a feel that I want to have a product which is like, I'll give you my example, maybe Coca-Cola with a dash of orange juice, with no sugar, with possibly a bit of ginger added in to give that slight nip, is somebody wants, and they want it now. And you cannot say my supply chain, okay, I'll go back to my R&D, I'll develop the product and give it to you after a year. You've lost it. Because after 3 months, the person may not want ginger. The person may want something else to be added to it. So your supply chain has to be re-engineered and geared to be able to deliver that. That's extremely important. And if you don't do that, it will not work. The other thing is the conventional business model. You eternally are in your R&D working for the perfect offering to the consumer. Then once that perfect offering comes, then you test it out for another few years. And then after 10 years, you have something being launched. Now today, it's all about vertical startups and scale-ups. I mean, 10 people get together in a room. They decide what they want to do. Next morning, you have a version in the market. Period. It's not the most perfect thing, but you have it. The consumer gets exposed to it. And then if they find, they keep improving it every day. The third day, they have already given their version 2. And then they are scaling it up as they are doing it. So it is very important for us to have a part of our system which can do this. Which can do this as well as 5 individual entrepreneurs. If you don't do that, you're going to really not be very, very successful. So I think this broadly defined what I believe we should do to handle disruption. And that's one of the big changes we have announced. I think if you have followed Coca-Cola in the last couple of years, our global CEO has made this change. He said, we're going to create a consumer-centric portfolio in every place we operate, which would be just not what we have, which will be a lot of stuff that we will develop, which are really based on hearing the consumer in that particular place. And that's something which we have really done. In fact, just give you a perspective, this year we are going to end up launching almost 15 products, which I think is historical from an India perspective, because we would have done one in 5 years or 6 years. So that's the sort of nature of change we have brought in, all delivered by hearing the consumer, very strong data analytics, which takes trends, which are not necessarily in our category. We really now look at trends beyond our category, so that we know at some point of time that trend will hit our category, so it may make sense for us to disrupt ourselves. I think what really helps is that when you get into data analytics, you can really move mass standardized products to customized targeted products. Like in the US, and which we will possibly get into India in the next year and a half or so, we have something called a freestyle equipment, where we really have, over a period of time, we capture data of a consumer so well that all you have to do is, as you go, you connect your mobile phone. The machine has the product ready for you. And you can change it if you want. It will tell you, hey, I think you like ginger more than sugar. So why are you changing from? So if you say, no, now I've given up ginger, it will notice that also. And the next time you go, you really connect your Bluetooth and say, hey, I'm here. And then it will tell you what drink you like. And you don't have to, you just go there, it will dispense, you take it, you pay for it and get out. So that's what data does to you. And this data becomes so intelligent because it is transacting with you some twice a day. So over 6 months, it captures all your idiosyncrasies also into it. As to, it knows after every 5 drinks, you change it to something drastically different. So it may prompt you saying it's your 6th drink. Are you going to go with the same or a different one? So that's what data can do to you. It can really make you, and people are excited because you just go there and it tells you what you like. And that really gives people so much more excitement than really you go there and you say, you have four products, can you take one of these? I mean, it's a changed world. I think the second thing, in a place like India, mass distribution was the order of the day. I mean, we made a product, we ensured every outlet had it, 10 million outlets. Now today, with the sort of data we have, we know what is the footfall in every outlet. We know, for instance, in Malabar Hill, in this grocery, the people who come in really like an orange-based drink. In this place, people like no sugar drinks. So we could actually distribute based on targets. That's the disruption you can create. Whereas if you don't have this, you will put every product, 70% of that will go bad, rot, and you will be writing it off. With this, you can really do horses for courses. This is again being piloted by us, and if it works, we will possibly make it happen all over the country. The second is we always had this big R&D stuff which developed products. Then we went around and see how we can really give this product to every country with a different message, etc. Today we have moved in from an inside out portfolio to an outside in portfolio. If somebody in India wants a masala based product, we will give a masala based product. If India milk based products are the big thing, we will do a milk based product. So I think that's how we have moved. And then now the key thing is we really have to, as an organization, have end-to-end business data put in one repository. In fact, at our place, we are trying to create something called the Knowledge Hub in India, where we would have all data available. So any person working for us can go and just dabble in it, and they will at least see what we visualize is going to be our market 10 years from now, various aspects of it. Because this will keep, we have to iterate it, because every disruption changes this picture. So, but we need to have a base vehicle on which we can make those changes. On supply chain, I've said it, it is consumer centric today. Now we want to get to a stage where you can go to a shop and produce your own product. And that's not the conventional supply chain. That has a lot of intelligence which has got to be built in, because you cannot have a marketing guy, a data analyst, all that in the point of sale. You ought to have everything on the back end which captures, and then you can just walk into a thing and press what you want, and then you put a bottle or whatever container you want, and then you just get dispensed what you want. It will ask you how you want to close it, you want to drink here, you want to seal it, take it back. That's going to be the future. It's not going to be really what we're doing today. So what does this mean for any organization? I mean, I'm specifically referring to big organizations, because I suppose I sit in one for a long time. So we need to really take our core business, which is bread and butter, which we need to really push. But at the same time, we need to keep building relevance for the existing business, because relevance is everything in life. And I've found that if there's one English word I really like, it's relevance. Because if you are relevant, you feel good about life. And relevance is not just in business. I had to work hard to build relevance with my children. I mean, these two people are in a completely different generation. And so every day I have to read up, I have to understand so that I'm relevant to them. Otherwise, your conversation starts and ends in 30 seconds. If I need to spend 2 hours with them, I need to really do some work to be relevant. So I think even for the core business, it's important. What was relevant a generation back need not be relevant today. So you need to build relevance. We have to put in whatever changes are needed and watch out for obsolescence, because obsolescence earlier could be very far-fetched and you may not even know what it is. But today, I think it could be finite. So it's important to do that. We should at the same time have an incubator, which is what I said. I mean, where you should be able to think, which should have things like digital capabilities, the ability to start vertical and quick scale up based on a whole lot of sort of tools. The key thing why you need this is you will keep seeing this consumer aspirations change. So you cannot go back like in the past and say, yeah, I'm going to see this, let me go develop it, I will test it for 2 years and third year I'll be there. It will not work, because somebody else is going to take it. I showed you the graph of some of the big companies in the US. You don't want to be in that space. So for instance, in our company in India now, we have an incubator where idea to market takes 12 weeks. So if you have an idea today, in 12 weeks, we could have the product on the shelf. If we don't do that, somebody else is going to do it. So every company needs to have this as a separate vertical, because this cannot be integrated with the core, because it's a hugely different mindset. It is the ability to go with something not absolutely perfect and keep making it perfect over a period of time. The core model is all about getting an absolute perfect swanky sort of product out. So these two cannot live together, so you need to keep it separately. So for me, I think there is no choice. We need to embrace disruption, because if we have been doing that for decades, for centuries. But I just want to again call out the fact that the pace has accelerated so much that you need to digitize to stay ahead of the curve. What does digitization do? Digitization at a very simplistic level gives you complete transparency of what's happening. So anything which is transparent can be changed faster. And anything which is backed by technology can be changed faster. So that's what digitization does. The second thing is innovating. I think innovation should be fast so that you can outpace the rapid changes. See, it's a question of a race, whether you innovate and outpace the change or the change outpaces you. It's always better to outpace the change, because you get better value when you outpace the change. For that, innovation is an absolute must. And innovation of any kind, I'm not only sticking to products and services, even processes, go to market. I think we need to innovate so that we are really agile and fast. And I think that's very important. And for me, democratization is very, very important trend for us to keep in mind. I think the more relevant, easy that we can make anything, I think we have a huge opportunity, because people embrace such things much easier than having to go and convince them. I mean, nobody could have convinced me to buy a camera. I would never have bought it in my life. But now I'm carrying a camera all the time, and I don't feel bad about it. We, in fact, clicked a few photographs in the campus also, which I would normally have done. I don't even have photographs of my wedding, because I never believed in this camera, photography, and all that. But then now I don't miss any day, because I can carry the camera in my pocket. So my wife keeps asking me, why is it now you... I said, it's so easy. I don't have to bother. I don't have any fear of failure, because I just look at it and click. So democratization is very important. People miss the plot in terms of democratization. The easier you make it, the more the usage will be, and the more your business will be. So I want to really conclude with what I started. I think keep internal thinking and execution rate greater than the consumer community aspiration and expectation. Then you don't have to do anything. You would be embracing disruption every day, every moment, and then you can be really happy. Let me thank you for giving me this opportunity.